In this webcast, we're going to examine the structures of the amino acids. We're going to look at the different R groups, or residual groups, the side chains of the amino acids, that make them all unique, that is, how they are different. As you go through this webcast, I would encourage you to keep engaged, keep your mind focused and attentive by asking yourself questions like why they are what they are and not otherwise. And I would also encourage you to stop as we go along and draw out the structures bond by bond, atom by atom. I think that aspect of drawing will help keep you engaged as well. Let's start with the aliphatic amino acids. The R group will in an aliphatic amino acid be an sp3 hybridized carbon, or in the case of glycine, just a hydrogen atom, and so we'll have a CH2 at the alpha carbon in the case of glycine. Alanine has a methyl group, valine has an isopropyl group, so the attachment is to the secondary carbon of the isopropyl group. Leucine has an isobutyl group. The isobutyl group has this structure here, and isoleucine has the sec-butyl group. It's kind of odd that leucine has an isobutyl group and isoleucine has a sec-butyl group. The sec-butyl group introduces a new stereocenter. This is the beta position, and so in the beta position there's a stereocenter as well as the stereocenter of the L configuration at the alpha position. Here are the structures of the amino acids that are aliphatic, drawn for you here. They've got the one-letter abbreviation as indicated. And if we look at how they are going to fill space, which is an important aspect of these, you can see that the aliphatic amino acids are hydrophobic, bulky, compact, and branched. Nature has selected amino acids that are ideally suited for packing and space filling. And in fact, what you're going to see is that these amino acids end up making the dense core of globular proteins. The ability of these groups to be compact, bulky, and hydrophobic allow them to really pack together tightly in globular protein fashion, providing stable, compact forms of proteins. The next set of amino acids are the aromatic and heterocyclic amino acids. Phenylalanine has the structure shown there. Tyrosine has the structure that's very similar. It has the CH2 phenyl group, but in the 4 position it has a hydroxyl group. These aromatic amino acids are capable of interacting in what's known as a cation pi interaction, and in the diagram that's shown over on the right, what we see is a phenyl ring on the bottom, and so that's going to have a negative electron cloud. That negative electron cloud of the aromatic ring will interact with an amino group that's actually going to be positively charged, so it's an ammonium cation, and that's the cation for the cation pi interaction. That's an important interaction in things like ion channels and other kinds of protein structures. The phenyl groups get involved in this kind of a non-covalent interaction. As far as heterocyclic amino acids goes, look at the structure of proline and look at how I've drawn it. Notice that it maintains that L-alpha configuration. Histidine is an aromatic amino acid that has the imidazole side chain, so that 5-membered ring is connected to a CH2, much like tyrosine and phenylalanine. It has that heterocyclic aromatic, and so it has 2 nitrogens. One is an N3 and one is an N2 type nitrogen at the positions with the connectivity that's shown there. Tryptophan has a very similar structure as well, and so you begin to pick up a lot of the similarities in structure. CH2 followed by a 5-membered ring that is heterocyclic. It has the nitrogen in the same position that the imidazole has in histidine, and then it's fused to a benzene ring. And so tryptophan has the structure that's shown there. Sulfur-containing and hydroxyl-containing, there are 4 of them, amino acids. Cysteine has a CH2 followed by a thiol group. This is important because the thiol group can undergo reversible oxidation and reduction. The reduced form has this, what's known as the sulfhydryl, or SH group. It can then become oxidized and make the sulfur-sulfur bond. This is what's known as disulfide bridges, or cross-linked forms of amino acids. We can see that the side chain of the amino acids connects the main chain, so the main chain is shown there, and the main chain of another segment is shown there, and then we have the side chains of the amino acids that are now cross-linked together through this disulfide linkage. The Newman projection is a view of the disulfide linkage where we're going to look at that sulfur-sulfur bond, and our eye is going to be positioned right down the sulfur-sulfur axis. And so you're looking at the sulfur-sulfur bond, and you see a CH2 and a CH2 group. They're about 90 degrees apart from one another. The second of the sulfur-containing amino acids is methionine. It has a CH2 and then a methyl thiol group. Serine has a CH2 and a hydroxyl group. Notice its similarity with cysteine. And then threonine has a stereocenter at the beta position. So our alpha carbon is here, and then our beta carbon has a hydroxyl group, and it has this additional methyl group. So it altogether has four different substituents. There's a new stereocenter at the beta position of threonine. Those are the hydroxyl-containing amino acids. There are amino acids that bear basic functionality, and those would be the epsilon amino group of lysine. And so if this is the alpha carbon, then connected to the alpha carbon at the R position is the beta carbon. And this is how I want you to remember the lysine. Lysine has an epsilon amino, so beta, gamma, delta, epsilon, and epsilon is attached to amino group. And in its new, and in under physiological pH, we're going to see that it's going to be cationic. Arginine is also a basic functional group. It's one of the strongest bases that exist in the side chains of the amino acids. Arginine has a delta guanidinium group, or guanidino group if it's neutral, guanidinium if it's charged, and that's always the form, almost always the form, that you're going to find it under physiological pH. I asked the question why it is that the proton adds to the nitrogen that is sp2 hybridized, and by now we can know that that's going to be the natural occurring location of the cation, because that allows the maximum amount of delocalized positive charge over all three of those nitrogen atoms. Whereas if you had attached that positive charge to this nitrogen atom, the cation would have been fixed only on a single atom. So maximum delocalization suggests that we protonate the sp2 nitrogen of the guanidine group. There are also some acidic side chains which under physiological pH are going to be in their anionic form. Aspartate has a carboxylate group attached to a CH2. It has a corresponding amide where that carboxylic acid oxygen is replaced by nitrogen. That's asparagine. The glutamate group has an additional CH2 followed by the carboxylate group, so it has one more CH2 than aspartate, and glutamine has that additional CH2 as well, and it's again oxygen replaced by nitrogen.